Random House Audio presents The Big Miss, My Years Coaching Tiger Woods, written and read by Hank Haney.
This book is dedicated to my wife, Suzanne, for her love and support.
Chapter 1. The Last Time. Finally, a moment of truth. Less than an hour before he'll tee off in the final round of the 2010 Masters, Tiger Woods walks onto the far corner of Augusta National's vast practice range. The other players and caddies sneak looks. A cheer rises from the packed grandstands, and the rowdier people squeeze together behind the green gallery ropes, yell encouragement from short range. Go, Tiger. You're the man. He might be disgraced, he might be a punchline, but he's still iconic. As he puts on his glove, the force of the collective gaze that always makes me uncomfortable when I'm walking with Tiger at a major championship is more penetrating. He's become more than just the greatest player alive. He's a human being who's fallen faster than anyone in history. The haters, the sympathizers, the commentators, everyone wants to see what it's done to him. So do I. Yes, he's been different since returning from an addiction treatment facility 6 weeks ago. More subdued, possibly shell-shocked, but I'm awaiting to judge whether he's changed as a golfer. Tiger has always been able to go to a special place mentally in the majors, and I'm eager to find out if he still can. Will he still be Tiger Woods? Passing golf's excruciating Sunday tests has always been what he does best, but this one feels most like a reckoning. Tiger is in third place, 4 strokes behind Lee Westwood and 3 behind Phil Mickelson. Without saying so, he said very little about anything all week. He knows that a good round today will gain him respect. And it's in the air that a victory would be even bigger than the 2008 U.S. Open at Torrey Pines, when he won on a broken leg. Finishing on top here might legitimately be judged the most dramatic win in golf history. It would mean redemption. A goal that suddenly seems more important than surpassing Jack Nicklaus's record of 18 major championships. Now it's go time. Tiger's Sunday warm-ups are traditionally works of art, especially when he's in contention. After 3 competitive rounds, he's usually distilled what is working to its essence, and using a mix of adrenaline and focus, he can go through the whole bag without missing a shot. Despite having watched Tiger hit thousands of balls, I still feel that thrill that comes with seeing him with full command at close quarters. His swing begins with serene poise at address, continues with a smooth gathering of power, and then, with the coordinated explosion that announces a supreme athlete, uncoils in a marriage of speed and control, the ball seemingly collected more than hit by the club face. As he relaxes into his balanced finish, the look Tiger gets on his face as he watches the ball is more peaceful than in any other moment. But something is wrong. After a few balls, I can see Tiger is strangely detached. He's taking too little time between swings, barely watching where the balls go, sometimes even taking one hand off the club before completing his follow-through. The flush yet cracking sound of his impact that for years has announced his superiority over other players isn't quite the same. He's having a terrible warm-up, almost as if he's not really trying. Other than a few quick grimaces of disgust, his face remains eerily stoic. I'm about 10 feet away, standing behind him along his target line, checking to see if his club shaft is on plane, marking his head movement, assessing the ball flight, weighing whether to say something or to continue to stay quiet. It's what I've done as his coach during countless practice sessions over the past 6 years, but he's acting as if I'm not there. I wait for some eye contact from Tiger, some words beyond a mumble, some sense of partnership in the warm-up and this moment. I get nothing. Since emerging from his meal in the clubhouse, he's switched to that cold-blooded ability to leave a person, even someone close to him, hanging. Amazingly, right here, right now, Tiger is blowing me off. This is the treatment. I got my initiation the second time I ever officially worked with him, on the practice range at Isleworth in March 2004. I'd stood my ground then, and I'm standing my ground now. Tiger doesn't respond well when underlings ask him if something's wrong, or worse, when they've done something wrong. His longtime but now former trainer, Keith Cleven, was always fretting about whether Tiger was mad at him. Rather than taking Keith's concern as a show of loyalty, Tiger saw weakness. In his world of testosterone-filled heroics and military hardness, that's unacceptable. He's never done this at a major championship when he's been in contention, so I'm not sure what he's thinking. My best guess is that he's carried over his aggravation from the night before, when the raw numbers on the scoreboard forced a realization that winning will be a long shot. He's probably telling me in a passive-aggressive way that he doesn't like the golf swing I've given him for this week. His swing problems could also be attributable to the pain in his chronically injured left knee or some other body part, but he hasn't complained about anything like that all week. Ultimately, there may be a far simpler reason for the chill I'm feeling from him. He's firing me in the non-confrontational way that's more common to a breakup than a professional relationship. Whatever is going on, I know one thing. He's not going to explain. I react clinically. Tiger is Tiger, in all his complexities, and my job is to adjust and to adapt to him and keep finding ways to get his best. That's always been a lot harder to do than people think. It turned out to be a lot harder than I thought. But since he's returned from the Mississippi Clinic, where he's followed a psychologically brutal program of self-examination, it's gotten harder still. He's playing in this Masters after his most rushed, most erratic, and poorest preparation for a major championship ever. 5 days before the first round, his game was so ragged it forced me to suggest a limited swing that cost him distance and shot-making versatility, but kept his misses playable. It's been a theme of my work with Tiger for much of our time together. Although it's commonly thought that Tiger plays go-for-broke golf and tries the most difficult shots with no fear, it's a false image. Tiger is above all a calculating golfer who plays percentages and makes sure to err on the safe side. What he abhors and has built his career on avoiding are the kinds of mistakes that produce bogeys or worse and kill momentum and confidence, wild tee shots that produce penalty strokes, loose approaches that leave no chance to save par, blown short putts. These blunders are the stuff of high scores, and after such a round, a tour player or caddy will often lament the big miss. Avoiding the big miss was a part of what made Ben Hogan and Jack Nicklaus great, and it's a style that Tiger has emulated. Until recently, his entire life seemed free of the big miss. But things change. It's why the game Tiger has brought to Augusta has been less powerful, less versatile, and less likely to shoot low numbers than his A game. But it's fulfilled its purpose by producing consistent scores of 68, 70, and 70 to stay in contention. Now Tiger knows that he'll almost certainly need something in the mid-60s to have a chance to win, and I'm getting the sense he's unhappy that the style of play we've prepared is going to lack the kind of firepower such a round usually requires. He's also aware that he's never come from behind on a Sunday to win any of his 14 major championships. In his current state, the odds are against his making that breakthrough, and it's not helping his mood. I have the feeling that Tiger is most aggravated that he's spotting 3 strokes to Mickelson. Tiger has always had a chilly relationship with Phil. Some of it is personality, but most of it is that Mickelson possesses the kind of talent that has made him a legitimate threat to Tiger's supremacy. Phil's popularity with the fans and gentle treatment from the media adds to Tiger's annoyance. For years, Tiger reveled in the idea that Mickelson had trouble playing in his presence. But Phil has adjusted, and in recent years, he's outplayed Tiger down the stretch in several tournaments. His increased confidence against Tiger, along with the positive energy of the gallery, has flipped the psychological advantage in their matchup in his favor. Phil has won 2 of the last 6 Masters. Both victories coming on the lengthened and narrowed Augusta course that has given Tiger, who won 3 of his 4 on the earlier design, trouble. I sense that Tiger has begun to press against Mickelson, making today's mountain that much higher. Then again, at this Masters, Tiger has already accomplished a great deal. In the first tournament he's played in 5 months, a period in which he suffered public humiliation, the painful regimented program designed to look into a psyche he never before questioned, the ordeal of his televised February 19th public apology, which was so anticipated that it preempted network programming, and the certainty that his wife will soon file for divorce, he's battled furiously and played amazingly well. He's made more mistakes than usual, but nearly offset them with short bursts of truly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.